breaking on an independent United Kingdom.
Meanwhile, we have young girls being beaten and raped, then ignored, labelled liars, and left defenceless because they're white.
On behalf of Autolycus, this is Trent Holmgren with the Europa Report for the past 2 weeks, June 17th to July 1st. Bringing you the latest news on the continent regarding the latest political developments and the ongoing refugee crisis. Let us begin with the United Kingdom, where on June 23, 2016, the United Kingdom voted to leave the European Union by 51.9% for leave and 48.1% for the Remain campaign. From thenewyorktimes.com, more than 17.4 million Britons voted June 23rd to sever ties with the European Union, whose seat of power lies in Brussels, compared to 16.1 million who voted to remain. The stunning vote, 52% to 48%, plunged world financial markets into turmoil. The political consequences for the Prime Minister of Britain were swift, and people around the globe reacted with shock and confusion. It would be the first time any country has left the bloc. Fear of being overrun by immigrants was a driving concern for Leave voters, who appeared to dominate the conversation on social media. Globalization concerns and a desire to wrest Britain from under Brussels' thumb were also factors. The referendum came about as a result of a promise made in 2013 by Prime Minister David Cameron to appease an increasingly vocal anti-European Union wing of his Conservative Party. As a result, the Prime Minister said he would step down. Mr. Cameron, who led the Remain campaign, announced on Friday that he had no precise timetable, but that he believed his successor, who will manage the process of leaving the Union, should be in place by October. Boris Johnson, the former mayor of London who backed leaving the EU, was considered a frontrunner to succeed Mr. Cameron, but on June 30th, Mr. Johnson announced he would not run for the position of party leader, and therefore prime minister. However, the referendum is not legally binding, though it is difficult to imagine that the British government would ignore the will of the voters. The process of leaving begins only after the British government invokes a provision of the European Union's governing treaty known as Article 50, an action Mr. Cameron said he would leave to his successor. Once Article 50 is invoked, though, Britain could not change its mind and stay in the Union unless the 27 other members all agreed. Regarding the impact of such a historical referendum, Britain would leave the world's largest common market with 508 million residents, including 65 million Britons. That would free them from the bloc's commitment to the free movement of labor, capital, goods, and services. Britain, which has the bloc's second largest economy after Germany, would have to come up with new trading agreements. Almost half its exports are sold on Europe's common market. On one side, London's role as a financial center would be imperiled, particularly if trade in euro-dominated securities moves to rival cities like Paris and Frankfurt. On the other side, the immediate effect on travel will be limited, especially as Britain was not a member of the passport-free Schengen zone, which came under heavy pressure last year from the refugee crisis. Americans will find bargains in travel to Britain because of more favorable exchange rates. Britain's security will be largely unaffected. It remains a nuclear power, a permanent member of the United Nations Security Council, and a leader of NATO. It is quite notable that Scotland and Northern Ireland could go their own way. Both voted overwhelmingly to stay in the EU, but prominent political leaders in Scotland and Northern Ireland called on Friday for new moves towards separating from Britain. Scotland, which voted in 2014 to remain in the United Kingdom, may revisit that referendum. Northern Ireland has an open border with the Republic of Ireland, a member of the bloc. Border crossings could now be tightened, and pressure could increase for unification, prompting instability in both places. As expected, calls for similar action have spread throughout Europe. We must now have the same referendum, French far-right National Front Party leader Marine Le Pen tweeted. Politicians made similar appeals in Denmark and the Netherlands. In Italy, one politician called for a referendum on whether to keep the euro currency. The importance of non-white immigration to Europe has been downplayed by the mainstream media in determining the Brexit result. Nevertheless, the migrant wave still carries on and its dire effects are still felt by Europeans on a continental level. Specifically, from newobserveronline.com, well over 7,000 sub-Saharan African invaders landed on the shores of Italy in just 2 days, bringing the total number so far this year to at least 60,000, the Italian government has announced. Separately, the European Union's border agency, Frontex, said that they are expecting 10,000 departures every week from Libya over the coming months. The African invaders are all falsely claiming to be asylum seekers and always referred to as migrants by the controlled media, are apparently taking advantage of the good summer weather to speed up their invasion of Europe. Let us remind that at least 1.8 million non-white invaders pretending to be asylum seekers have entered Germany since 2014 and are still currently there, irrespective of whether their applications have been approved or not. According to a report in Die Welt newspaper, the only country which has taken in more asylum seekers than Germany is Turkey. As of April 30th, 2016, more than 1.5 million non-whites had either completed asylum applications or were busy with ongoing applications in Germany, Die Welt said, quoting government sources. Among them, as the Rheinische Post reported, a militant Muslim non-white invader who was once Osama bin Laden's bodyguard has been given asylum in Germany, because being sent back to Tunisia would mean that he faces the risk of being tortured. Also, from NewObserverOnline.com, despite demands by the conservative mayor of Calais that the jungle of non-white invaders outside her town be moved to Britain following the Brexit vote, the French government has confirmed that there is no chance of this happening. Several UK-based newspapers have also started scare stories that the jungle will be moved to Britain, that will now be easier for them to cross the channel, but none of these rumors are true. According to an article in Le Parisien, French Foreign Minister Jean-Marc Ayrault dismissed a call by Calais Mayor Natasha Bouchard, a member of Nicolas Sarkozy's Le Républicain, made on French broadcaster BFM TV, that the British must take on the consequences of their choice. We are in a strong position to push, to press this request for a review, and we are asking the President to bring his weight to the issue. By the way, the French government has refused to even consider holding a French European Union membership referendum, Front National leader Marine Le Pen has said. In addition, she said, the EU intends to make the Brexit process as painful as possible as to teach any other would-be leavers a lesson. Le Pen made the announcement after attending an emergency meeting of all the major political party leaders at the Élysée Palace on Saturday to discuss the Brexit vote. The meeting, called by French President François Hollande, also attended by Nicolas Sarkozy. All three, Hollande, Le Pen, and Sarkozy, are expected to take part in next year's presidential elections. On Friday, July 1st, Austria's Constitutional Court has ordered May's presidential election to be annulled and another called after particularly serious cases of voting fraud were detected in the photo finish vote. From Breitbart.com/London, the Green Party-backed candidate Alexander van der Bellen originally snatched victory by a mere 0.6% in the second round vote, which was taken to decide the new president of the Central European state, Austria, in May. He had made it to the round alongside Freedom Party candidate Norbert Hofer, who campaigned to protect Austria from mass migration and Islamification. Now the Austrian Constitutional Court has upheld a complaint by the FPO about conduct in the election. The party had alleged that there were voting irregularities in 94 of the 117 total electoral constituencies in the country, reports Kronen Zeitung. This is a fortunate turn of events amidst escalating migrant crime in Austria. Moreover, Austrian police have arrested another three non-whites pretending to be asylum seekers who fought with or helped rebel groups in Syria and Iraq that are classed by Vienna as terrorist organizations, the police have announced. From NewObserverOnline.com, the invaders, two Iraqis and one Syrian, were arrested in refugee centers in the western state of Tirol, local police chief Helmut Tomak said. According to a report in the Österreichische Rundfunk, the 27-year-old Syrian fought for al-Qaeda's Syrian affiliate, al-Nusra Front, and killed 20 members of government forces, including prisoners. The Iraqi has already confessed to his membership of al-Nusra, police said. In other news, Denmark has begun confiscating large amounts of cash and valuables from migrants in order to help fund their housing, healthcare, and food. From Breitbart.com/London, the controversial Jewelry Act, proposed late last year, stirred controversy worldwide after some compared the move to Nazi practices during the Second World War. The law is meant to relieve some of the pressure from taxpayers for the burden of housing, feeding, clothing, and providing health care to new migrants. Although the law has been on the books since February, this month marks the first time it has ever been put into practice, Zeit reports. Also, moving on to news from the Visegrad 4, Hungarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban has slammed the inappropriate approach to mass migration pursued by the European Union, which he blames for having pushed Britain out of the power bloc. Speaking from Brussels and laying the foundations for Hungary's own forthcoming referendum on the European Union, Mr. Orban said it was time for the EU to learn that it could not survive as a dictatorial system ruling 500 million people from Belgium. Explaining how the present approach to the European project has pushed the British away and was going to alienate other nations too, Mr. Orban said, "You do not sit on a horse backwards. The EU is not in Brussels. It has 27, presently 28, capital cities." He remarked, "We must return to the idea that the European Union is based on members rather than EU institutions." According to Reuters, the EU's future cannot be decided by just two or three powerful Western members, Slovakia's prime minister said on Thursday in a dig at France and Germany and a plea for more involvement by the bloc's newer ex-communist members. Prime Minister Robert Fico was speaking on the eve of taking over the rotating presidency of the European Union, which has been shaken to its core by Britain's shock vote to leave. The other 27 EU leaders will meet in Bratislava in September to ponder the future. Crucial decisions about the future of Europe cannot be defined by 2-3 member states or the founding states of the EU, Fico told reporters. The future of the EU can no longer be defined without active involvement of the states that joined after 2004, Fico said. The bulk of the post-2004 entrants are former communist nations from Central and Eastern Europe. Lastly, alternative plans are drawn for the future of the EU. Specifically, the Socialist Party, foreign ministers of Germany and France have drawn up a proposal for European Union superstate following the UK's Brexit vote. The 9-page document demands that all EU states adopt common criminal codes, tax systems, immigration, and asylum policies, and to be forced to accept a redistribution of the flood of fake refugees. The document, first leaked by Polish state television broadcaster Telewizja Polska, TVP, has been confirmed as genuine and is likely to be placed before the European Commission within the next few weeks for approval. Titled A Strong Europe in a World of Uncertainties, the document was written by Jean-Marc Ayrault, French Minister of Foreign Affairs, and Frank-Walter Steinmeier, his German counterpart. Starting off by lamenting Brexit as a watershed moment in the history of Europe, the two said that they have to acknowledge that support and passion for our common project has faded over the last decade in parts of our societies. Well, that was all for this week, guys. For TRS Radio, this has been The Europa Report. The Europa Report is a compilation of selected articles from the following sites: NewObserverOnline.com, Breitbart.com/London. Please support their efforts.